2 months ago, I was asked or was write something for a lecture here. So that's what's in the book. And then I thought, I have to work this out. And then I wrote a book, which became this, which was printed last week. It's a very simple book. It's a book that I basically wrote for the smart shops in Amsterdam. Because they sell 2 portions of mushrooms and this and that and that, and they want their customers that pay 30, 40 pounds or euros to go out of the shop and they get a book for 5 euros, then at least they know something. So I wrote the book. And then I come here and I made this this thing. And now I'm here and I thought the rest of the afternoon is about time. So, time and ritual. Let's start with that. My real specialty is rituals. And psychedelic rituals are only part of that. There are many rituals you can do. I think praying is a ritual, meditation is a ritual, dancing around naked, whatever, anything. I even agree slowly with Hans Cousteau, who said that raves and these parties we have these days, these festivals, are also ritual. People go there to be together and have this feeling. So ritual, what does ritual do for us? Now ritual is very important because it brings together 3 worlds. And now I think I have to... We do that. Ritual brings together 3 worlds. My inner world, my psychology, what I think, my outer world, which is what I can see and touch and feel, including my body, and this third world. The third world is the other world, the spiritual world. Name it what you want. Call it heaven, call it psychonautic space, call it the heavenly realms, I don't care. But there is something out there that we should look at. Now I have to see if I can do this in an easy way. Or could you? Yeah, one more. Okay. 3 worlds. The problem I have with the research in psychedelics is that they look at 2 worlds only, and the 3rd world is a subjective one. So everybody writes about how you can measure brain waves, health effects, serotonin, whatever, which is still touchable, tangible reality. And they talk about what happens in the mind. Even people like Stan Grof, they talk about holotropic breath work and LSD. And that's my inner world, it's my outer world. It's not about magic. My interest is in magic. So let's not talk about what happens in your head or what happens in your hands or in your body when you take drugs. You know all about it, I hope. Yes? Let's see what the ritual does. I have to go stand here, sorry, because it's not... I have ease all this. That's what I mean. We have 3 worlds. An extra dimensional world, and you can say this is what the quantum physicists talk about. They say there's 11 dimensions. Well, I took them to be one and I call it the other world. As you can see, the world, the others, the outer world, the inner world. What does ritual do? It addresses the 3 worlds. Now you can say, that's not what a ritual do, because I go to mass and... No, you go to mass and you pray. Which means you address God, or you address whatever, Allah. And you pray and you expect something. You're addressing the other world. We all do. Because what is in the other world? All the intangibles. Think about yourself as having senses for this other world. Now you think this is crazy, because I can see, I can hear, I can feel. No. You know beauty. You know justice. You know kinship. If you meet someone, there's a lot of things you know. Now you say, it's my eyes. No, you feel that. If you see a painting, you feel beauty. Now these are another way of interaction. And I call these senses, the senses to address the other world, primes, by, you know, call it anything. But I think we have senses to address the other world. And here comes psychedelics. Because the psychedelics, as you can see, relay those two worlds. Yes, they also relate the psyche to the body and you feel all that kind of stuff, but this is what interests me. How I can use psychedelic to get in touch with the other world. Not as hypothetical, not as a dream, as a subjective experience. How can I address the spiritual extra dimension? Well, I take a little bit of LSD, and how do I do that? Because I also can go to a rave and have fun and nothing. So how should we take that? We should use a ritual. And then we come back to what Leary and all the people said. If you use a psychedelic in a ritual setting, you have to look at set and setting. Now, I don't have to explain this yet, that you have to have intention, you have to have an agenda, a sacred space, group mind. You can look at yourself. But this last one is what I am really interested in. Magical intent. What do you want to achieve? Now, don't say that we don't do this, because many, many people take psychedelics for healing. If you go to all these ayahuasca retreats out down there in South America or in Amsterdam, or I was in Ibiza, man, I think there were 15 ayahuasca sessions in one night at different places. Why do people go there? Many people go there because they want to find some healing, psychological healing, but also serious, serious medical healing. And you know the story, the Santo Daime people, they go there and say, oh, I had a brain tumor or whatever, whatever. Yes? That's what we want. Magical intent. Healing. And what is healing different from magic? If you just think about the mystical part, where you see God and you have the oceanic feeling, and you see the magical part, what's in the middle? In the middle is healing. Healing is already a bit magical. Of course, it's a bit, healing is accepting who you are, which helps. If you accept that you are in this or that situation, it helps, but it's also you want to try to change it. So that's what a ritual does. Yeah? It can help you to get there. I made this little timeline of a typical trip, and I show it to you, not because it's important, but it's something I miss in all the books. You see there, Ben sitting there, but I like simple graphs that explain how a trip works. Yeah, and there's lots of words in all those books, but not these, you see? It's very simple, yeah? How it starts, and you all know this. You're this stage and that stage, and you vomit, and you go up, and there is the energy drain. We call this the Tuesday dip in on Ibiza, yeah? And then the flashbacks. But you see how simple it is to, for someone who has never taken it, to get some idea of what is going to happen. And yes, it will, there's a little things there, you might come back and this and that and that. It's just kind of a general thing. And of course you can get numbers, you can say, well, if I take ecstasy, this takes 30 minutes, and if I take iboga, it takes 45 minutes, and you can work it out. And how high is the trip, and I'm sure that all this, your scientists not only will figure it out by questionnaires, but finally say, oh, your serotonin is 0.5 this, and your whatever. Coming back to rituals. Why are rituals so unbelievably important? Why are rituals used for psychedelic practices all through the ages? You've all heard about the Vedas. But today someone told me that the Australian Aboriginals also take psychedelics. Of course, we expected nothing else, but he kind of confirmed what we know, that the people, the Bwiti and the people in the jungle of South America, they all use it. Why are rituals important? It's something that nobody writes about. I think I wrote the first book on ritual for years. And the reason was that before that, ritual was part of the Christian thing, you know, so you had professors in theological ritual, whatever theory of ritual, and they only wrote about the the mass and stuff like that. So it was kind of, then Stan Krippner, good friend of mine, started writing about shamanic rituals, and now we're back to what it means, yeah? You see that thing? Cultural intelligence. A ritual is something that carries so much. Just imagine, before we human beings could talk, before there was language, before there was symbolic understanding, people would do rituals. Animals do rituals, we know that. Elephants, when they see the bones, the remnants or the carcass of an elephant, they stop to mourn. And more amazingly, if it's a carcass of one of their own, they mourn longer. Yeah? So animals do it, with many, many examples of animals that do rituals. So humans do rituals. It's very important. Before we could talk, we did rituals. Rituals came forth from game and will turn into law. Please understand, law today is a codified ritual. Yeah, you don't think so, but go to a courthouse and you see how they still do it, where the people are sitting up, down, standing, sitting. Okay. Okay, now, the question is, why do rituals work? And then I have to explain something about my vision on who we are, because it's a psychological process. And I believe psychedelic rituals, psychedelics by themselves, help you to get from your assumed self. Now, this is a strange word, but you could read ego there. But Freud kind of took that word and, yes, yeah, so I use the word assumed self. Yeah? That what you think you are. Actually, there might be more of that in you. But there is something on the other side, inside of you, which we call the inner child, inner me. Again, whatever word, true self. What does a ritual do? It brings you from the assumed self to the inner self. And why is that important? Because that's where healing happens. And remember, part of what we try to do is by praying or healing is to change something, which I call magic. We can do that only on that inner me level. That's where we are in touch with who we really are. The rest is assumed self, is a mirror. I look at myself in the mirror. There's an I and there is me, myself. Yeah, images. Subjective. But somewhere that inner me is objective. I also show you the shown self. That is the reason that if you see this, many, if you go to a psychotherapist and you say, oh, I'm so nice, but nobody understands me. Help me. So what does the guy does? He says, well, you smile a little bit more, or you open your hands, or you know, whatever psychotherapists do to help you to fix yourself. If you look at the left side of this, it's a whole different story there. You go from the assumed self, from the ego, you let go of it, let go of the material needs, let go of all your needs, and you go to what we could call the inner child, inner me, true self. There's where healing happens. Believe me, psychotherapists don't like this little picture. Yeah? But I think it works. Why do I make this distinction between the me or self dimension and the other dimension? Because once you get there, once you get into the inner me, and of course it doesn't always work so well, but if you get there, you get out of time and out of space. And this is where all these people talk about, they have a mystical experience. Why? Because the ritual takes them there. And again, psychedelics help, but stand on your head, do yoga, pray, whatever. Yeah? Rituals are ways to get into your inner self. Get in touch with who you really are. And that's another dimension. I've shown it here a little bit, that there's a subject dimension, subjective dimension, a self dimension, and there is an objective dimension. So the whole process is how to get you there. Let go of the ego. Do away with it. So if you stage a ritual, or if you stage a psychotherapeutic session, that's what you try to do. Bring people in contact with themselves. How do you do that? You take the pictures of their parents, you play the nice music, you make sure they feel good. Sometimes you have to push them a little bit because they are hiding, little confrontation, and a good therapist knows how to do it. But I also, from experience, I must say, your mother, your father, your sister, or the neighbor can be a very good therapist if he's nice and understands you. So you don't have to go and travel to South America to do that. Yeah? This is what I just showed you. To start with, I believe there's two time dimensions. I'm a physicist. Modern quantum physics says this is possible. There might be two time dimensions within the framework of an 11-dimensional string model. If you have two time dimensions, philosophers among you will see this. You have determinism and you have free will. Ah, what a problem! What a problem this was in philosophy. We couldn't merge it. I've solved it. There are two time dimensions. One dimension where you can have causation, which means change, which means something different, and one where things just go normally linear causality. So one dimension where there's a rational causality and one where there isn't, where you can see the future, where you can see the past, where you can do magic, everything. That's what magic is. Get out of the limitations of time and space, and psychedelics are a great way to do that. Okay. Did you ever think that you could use the chakra system to identify different drugs? And by the way, religions and stuff like that? If you see that everybody says, yeah, of course it's true, ecstasy is the heart. If I have a person with a heart problem, give them some ecstasy and they open the heart. If I have a someone with a little problem more in the sex region, give them a little bit of peyote. And there are many more. Iboga is something that takes you very, very deep in an existential level. Do you recognize this picture? Like, makes sense? Yeah? Very handy. So, you meet someone and you think, that is a brainer. Yeah? Really? You have these guys? Do you give them LSD? No, no, no. That's what they like. They like LSD because they're in the brain and they like to be there. But if they want to grow, in a ritual sense, psychotherapy, don't give them LSD. Give them something to open the heart or to get horny or whatever. Yeah? But they like to go where they, you know, on their own territory. So a brainer likes to be on the LSD. But it's not good for them, in the sense, if you want to grow. So this is a very simple model that I use. I look at people and say, ah, what chakra is there, and then I know what to give. Very often, and you know that too, it's no news, that sometimes you need a little ecstasy to help the LSD trip to work, or vice versa, yeah? Why are the chakras here, and why you can see that this is probably for you not so interesting, you know all that, yes? Oh, by the way, if you look at religions, the heart is Christian, the throat is Jewish, and Muslim. This, the third, is of course the Hindu. They don't talk about love, they talk about power and truth, yes? Fertility, you come by the tantric guys, and somewhere with division is Buddhist, and contemplation maybe Sufi kind of stuff. So very handy scale. When doing therapy, you want to know what someone needs. And I made a list here, and I discussed it with Shulgin and other people about things. And I have a few copies here, and you really don't look at the details, but just this gives qualities for cannabis, ecstasy, what is it, ayahuasca, LSD, mushroom, mescaline, ketamine, and alcohol, with numbers. We all know that ecstasy is more of an empathogen than cannabis. But did you know that alcohol is also, like, not too bad in that respect? Alcohol is a very good psychedelic. In therapy, especially for specific kinds of people with specific problems, we use alcohol better than another drug. Sometimes we use, tobacco, yes? They're all very powerful, but not for someone, of course, who has been drinking all their life. Yeah, but if you've never had alcohol, it might be a very, very interesting thing. Especially for people with mixed sexual subpersonalities. I can explain that. The word that Freud used for that is refoulé, very deep repressed sexuality. Then alcohol is the drug of choice. And my example there is Prince. Yeah, you know Prince? Yeah? Gay inside, horny, heterosexual on the outside. Very mixed personality. If he would come to me, I would give him a lot of alcohol, you know, and not a little bit, but you know. Yeah? Okay. Numbers. This is all in my books. Now, 2 minutes about the future. What are we going to see? New drugs. This is nothing new. We'll have them. I've been at Shulgin's many times, and every time I never asked for it, he would give me something new. And I've had drugs that made me clear hearing. Really amazing. You know, the birds were saying, really. And something he gave me was that made me see the future. Amazing drugs. And he made him, I think, every week a new one. It was an amazing guy, but he's dead. What we'll see is the law will give into more permissive use. Hopefully. More combination. This is what I see also here. More people are now actually using drugs in combination with a therapy. I spoke with someone who wants to do creativity therapy, and he wants to use it. Now, this is what's important. The study to say what the psychedelics do and what many people research is not so interesting. Let's work it. They're tools. Not tools to find out about psychedelics. They're tools to be creative, to do relationship therapy, to create new inventions. Yeah, I would like to see much more research in going into therapy for, well, you know, I come from the business world where we had brainstorming sessions, yeah? Not many companies like Shell would hand out a few pills to do that. But I would like to see what that is, and if people like Ben will make up protocols to describe that, to find out how that exactly worked, what are the dimensions. Because you have to understand, innovation and creation is not only positive. You have to beat the guys. Yeah, all the great inventions were not done because people were so happy. Einstein found these things out because he was actually, you know, he was only a teacher actually in physics, and he couldn't find a job. He worked with the patent office, and you know, and then he did his inventions, kind of under pressure to prove himself. So creativity is not only being nice, giving more money. One of my subjects is diversity. I'm an advisor to the city of Amsterdam and write things about that. It's not only good to have very good schools with lots of money. No, no, you have to make differentiations. You have to have bad times. To get art, you need people, you know, pressure, confrontation, all the stuff. And I would like to see how psychedelics can work in that respect. And I know it's not popular to say, okay, we're going to give you a little bit of LSD and we're going to hit you and see what you do. Yeah? But we might learn a lot from that instead from just pampering them. Yeah. Okay. More matching of personality and drug. That's what I showed you. Look at the personality and find out. My first drug experience was in Esalen by what you could call a witch. And she made me eat so much mushrooms. And then she blew me something in the nose. I think that was DMT. And she took me to a whole night of different things. Yeah, including taking me under the shower and having great sex, yeah? Which was, and she had all kind of different stuff to do that. She massaged me with oil and whatever. That was what I learned, that a psychedelic ritual trip can be an amazing experience if you expand it beyond just taking LSD or whatever you have, yeah? And we have to find out. Some people need this drug, other people need that, some people need that combination. That's where we have to go. More understanding, not everybody taking the same stuff in the same group. Yep. Understanding multidimensional spiritual effects is what I would say, what I talked about magic. Yeah, there is more. Magic is really a part, and we can talk about the mystical experience and still see it as some kind of psychological phenomena. No, we have contact with another world, and we always have. Human history wouldn't be full with books like the Bible or the Vedas if there was nothing to it. They would have stopped with it long time ago. The Eleusinian mysteries wouldn't have lasted for, what was it, 800 years if there was nothing to it. There was effect, effectiveness of what it is. And then we have to come to understanding what thinking is. There's someone in London here, Marilyn Monk. She was the inventor of epigenetics. There's an E missing. Epigenetics, not Bruce Lipton. I know him too, but... And she lately said, thinking, and now think about it, thinking is using this thing here as a tuner. Thinking is not, this is not the computer. This is a tuner. And what do we use to tune our brain, our memory? She says we're using DNA epigenetic changes. Epigenetic change means that in the DNA you switch off and on certain things. Yeah, you do it with some chemical process, and it takes half a second to a second before you can do that. It's not very fast. Now think about, you know, you think about your mother. Now I think about my mother and nothing, and then slowly her image comes up, and slowly, oh yeah, the house, yeah. Yeah, it takes half a second, it takes a second, and then I open up. It's like inside my brain I tune this to my mother's image. But I could also tune it to special relativity or the map of San Francisco or your name or whatever. Yeah. So she thinks that thinking is a DNA process. Yes, something in our brain tuning to what is out there. We can call it Akashic, consciousness, whatever. Now, this is revolutionary. This is not what science thinks. Some people say the brain is a tuner. There are more people who think like that. But she came up with some kind of explanation. I don't know whether it's true or not, but I think it's a great idea. Yeah? Okay, I think I'm through with my time, more or less.